On this week's show, how the Chevy Bolt EV could sell up to 80,000 units in its first year of sales, Tesla lays out the risks associated with Model 3, and why this week was a big one for Elon Musk's Hyperloop. These stories and more coming up next on 10. Enjoying today's show on YouTube and want to read the stories we're referring to today? Just head to our website at transportevolve.com/TEN, where you'll find today's show notes, as well as links to the latest future car news, buying guides, tech primers, and car reviews. It's Friday, May 13th, 2016. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield, and this week has just been jam-packed with news. So I'm going to dive right in with our first story, courtesy of the Chevrolet Bolt EV. As those who pay attention to the electric car industry will know, the Bolt EV is General Motors' first 200-plus-mile electric car and is due to enter production later this year. Often described as a car that will cross-shop with the upcoming Tesla Model 3 due to its price, around $37,500 before incentives, the Bolt EV could make GM a real volume seller in the all-electric car marketplace, especially if it's marketed properly. How much of a volume seller? Well, according to Kelly Blue Book analysis Carl Brauer, anywhere from 30,000 to 80,000 examples are expected to be sold in its first year, placing the Bolt EV on par with some of Chevy's mainstream entry-level cars in terms of sales figures, cars like the Chevy Sonic and Chevy Spark. The comments were made in a Barron's article, in which Brauer even suggested that the inevitable delays to the Tesla Model 3 Tesla does have yet to bring a car to market on time or on budget, could mean that GM could steal some customers away from the California automaker if it was able to ramp production up quickly enough when Bolt begins to roll off its production lines later this year. While I'm personally not sure of that fact, Tesla fans are generally quite a loyal bunch, and I don't think these two cars cross shop. I do think that the hype surrounding Model 3 has done wonders for the electric car industry as a whole, and moreover, there's plenty of room for GM, Tesla, and Nissan, and others, to produce long-range, high-volume electric cars. After all, it's the transition to renewable energy and sustainable transport, not the badge, that's the important bit, right? We mentioned it in the last story, so it now seems as good a time as any to talk about the Tesla Model 3, a car which I can safely say is the only vehicle in history to attract more attention pre-launch than the original Apple iPhone. Anyway, while hardened Tesla fans and true believers have been working hard to dispel any sense, any notion that Tesla may not make its promised late 2017 production goal for Model 3, the company admitted that it was a possibility this week in its official US Securities and Exchanges Commission documents. But while some news sites have already run away screaming at this admission, LA Times, I'm looking at you, we think it's time to put some context to these statements. You see, the "we might not make this on time" type statements were made as part of the standard form 10Q that all publicly traded US companies must submit quarterly to the SEC. Part of that form includes a section entitled Risks, in which the company has to essentially state all of the things that could conceivably go wrong with any and all future plans. In other words, it is a part of the form where companies have to say what they could conceivably see as going wrong, destroying the company worth or prospects in the process. Given so much of Tesla's future business model hinges on Model 3's success, it's natural that Model 3 featured so much in the document. And as Tesla quietly notes, it hasn't yet finalized design or specification for its $35,000 electric car. But as we noted on Tuesday, this document is about Tesla acknowledging risk, something every business has to do in order to succeed. Right now, there's no need to panic, and if that changes, we'll let you know. We're off to the UK now for our next story and news of an exciting new project involving Nissan and energy company Enel. At the start of the week, as part of celebrations to mark Nissan's investment in future energy and transportation solutions, Nissan and Enel launched a new vehicle-to-grid pilot project in which both private and fleet Nissan electric car owners can sign up to use their vehicles as grid-connected storage devices, charging up during off-peak periods and then selling the electricity in their car's battery pack back to their local utility during peak power periods. It's essentially an extension of the leaf-to-home system we've seen demonstrated in Japan, where a specially designed charging station can put power into a Nissan Leaf or ENV200 minivan using the CHAdeMO port, as well as pull that power back out again when required. The Japanese system is designed primarily to enable homeowners to use their electric car as a backup power supply in the case of a disaster. But the UK system is designed slightly differently. It's designed to help the aging national grid cope with periods of peak demand by capturing energy when demand is low and then feeding it back to the grid during high periods. Given participants can stand to make some money in the process, I really can't see why you wouldn't want to take part. Just under 3 years ago, Tesla CEO Elon Musk penned Hyperloop Alpha, a new technical white paper laying out a brand new way to send people and things over long distances at high speed without burning a single drop of fossil fuels. And this week, we heard two very exciting pieces of news from the two Hyperloop companies seeking to bring that technical white paper to commercial reality. As we explained on Tuesday, the first piece of news came from Hyperloop Transportation Technologies, or HTT for short, that it had signed a licensing deal with the Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory, a federally funded research institute, to license a passive repulsion technology that could make building the Hyperloop far cheaper and more efficient than the type of active repulsion technology used in traditional magnetic levitation systems. Sadly, we don't have time to go into the tech here, but in short, the passive repulsion technology uses magnets rather than electromagnets to keep the hyperpod loop hovering above the track. Rather than requiring the entire Hyperloop track to be electrified, this system could make it far cheaper to build and maintain Hyperloop systems, relying on batteries on board the capsules themselves to power the capsules down the track, instead of using external power sources. HTT says we'll hear more of this technology in the coming months, so keep watching for more news. Staying with Hyperloop, I think this is the first time we've had two Hyperloop stories in the same month, let alone the same week, HTT's biggest rival, a company that used to be known as Hyperloop Tech, rebranded itself this week as Hyperloop One. It also held a special two-day press event just north of Las Vegas, Nevada, where it announced the successful completion of its second round of VC funding, talked about some of its hopes for the future, and demonstrated the levitation and propulsion technology it plans to use to make its version of Hyperloop a reality in the near future. In terms of funding, a total of $80 million has been procured in Hyperloop One's B round investment, including investment from Western Technology Investment, GE Ventures, and SNCF, yes, the French National Rail Company. Following the announcement, members of the press were teased to a short demonstration of Hyperloop One's technology, a 10-foot sled levitating above a makeshift track, which was sent hurtling down a half-mile track at speeds of about 116 miles per hour before being stopped by a massive sandpit at the other end. They haven't figured out the brakes yet. Sure, it's a long way from the fully enclosed capsules we'll eventually all ride in, but this is exciting stuff and I want to see and experience it firsthand. I can't wait. We're back to the world of cars now with a Tesla story that will interest those of you who have just purchased an entry-level Tesla Model S70 or Tesla Model S70D from the California automaker. You see, as it turns out, as part of the mild refresh to Model S made last month, Tesla quietly changed the battery pack capacity of its entry-level Tesla Model S, increasing it from 70 kilowatt hours to 75 kilowatt hours when no one was looking. But to keep the entry-level price point the same, Tesla decided to introduce a software lockout, preventing people from using that extra 5 kilowatt hours unless they opted to pay extra for it. The result? Each and every facelift Tesla Model S 70 and 70D that's been made can be upgraded to the Tesla Model S 75, the announcement for which we covered on last week's show, for just a one-off fee of just around $3,000. And it can be done over the air. Of course, it's not the first time we've seen Tesla do this. Back when Tesla first launched, it offered customers a 40 kilowatt hour option for Model S. Since so few people actually ordered one, it ended up fitting 60 kilowatt hour batteries and then used a software lockout to ensure that 40 kilowatt hour customers could only access 40 kilowatt hours of the battery. Clever. Tesla might have cornered the over-the-air software update and software battery capacity limitations, but it seems that Nissan wants a piece of the energy storage market that Tesla is currently trying to tie up with its Tesla Energy products. That's because on Monday, the same time it announced the vehicle-to-grid project we mentioned earlier on in this show, Nissan announced a new energy storage product being developed, which will hit the market this fall. Called the X-Storage system, it combines Nissan's lithium-ion battery experience with power specialist equipment T.E.N to offer customers the capability to store electricity from the grid or local renewable energy generation for use later in the day, and also as a backup power source if grid power is cut. Starting at just €4,000, including installation for a 4.2 kilowatt hour system in the EU, Nissan and T.E.N say the unit will be available to pre-order from September. Nice. from battery energy storage and use now to hydrogen fuel cells in the form of the Toyota Mirai hydrogen fuel cell sedan, or rather the successor to the current high-priced, handmade, low-volume Toyota Mirai being sold today. That's because mid-week, Toyota reiterated its plans to bring a lower-cost version of the Mirai, most likely one which will share the same name, to market in just 3 years' time. It will be priced around $10,000 less than the existing model. And at the heart of the new model will be a more efficient design that can be made more easily and can be automated through its production, reducing build cost and sticker price. Toyota hopes to have it on the road in time for the 2020 Tokyo Olympics, which it's sponsoring, which means it will enter production towards the end of 2019. But with electric cars now beating hydrogen in affordability, range and performance, it's doubtful that Toyota's Mirai will gain much attention outside of hydrogen-friendly Japan, primarily because no other nation has a hydrogen infrastructure that could sustain the use of such vehicles. Oh well. Staying in Japan, but pivoting somewhat for the next story, we heard on Thursday this week that Japanese automaker Nissan, and presumably its alliance partner Renault, has just purchased a 34% stake in struggling Mitsubishi Motors for $2.2 billion, making it the majority shareholder in the rival firm. The move, something of a lifeline for Mitsubishi, will not only give Nissan some new potential markets to explore, but it will also ensure that the brand gets to benefit from Nissan's existing electric vehicle programs. To date, Mitsubishi has chosen to focus more on plug-in hybrid SUVs than pure electric cars. So we will be interested to see just what Nissan's controlling stake in Mitsubishi does to both the brand and its image. Of course, it should also help Mitsubishi shake off some of the connotations of its own emissions scandal, in which it knowingly overestimated the fuel economy of some of its K-Class cars on the Japanese fuel economy tests. And finally, we finish today's show with a cautionary tale of what not to do if you happen to own a luxury Tesla Model S or Tesla Model X electric car with autopilot features enabled. That's because this week, a new story broke in Utah of a Tesla Model S owner who told the local press that its luxury Model S electric car drove itself into the front of a parked trailer without any input from him, without him in the car. The car, parked front on to the front of the trailer in question, didn't detect the trailer until it was too late, causing some significant damage to the front of the owner's car. But aside from parking on the wrong side of the road in the opposite direction to the flow of traffic, it turns out that the driver, at least according to Tesla, inadvertently activated the car's automated auto-park feature when exiting the vehicle, a feature that Tesla cautions owners should only be used on private land, not public highway. Tesla says before the feature can be initially activated, there's a disclaimer that the owner must read and agree to before the car can be used, and notes that the driver double-tapped the park button before getting out of the vehicle, the way AutoPark is activated from within the vehicle. So in this case, if you have a Tesla with AutoPark, the lesson is clear. Make sure you pay attention to Tesla's advice, or you too may have a very expensive repair bill on your hands. Well, that's it for today. You'll note that we're well over 10 minutes in length, but hey, we covered 10 stories today. That's value for money, right? All being well, I'll be back next week at the same time with another episode of 10. And in the meantime, you can find all the news that's fit to print at our website at transportevolve.com, catch up with us on Twitter at transportevolve, or check out our latest shows on our usual YouTube channel. And if you liked what you saw today, please consider keeping us independent and impartial by supporting our Patreon crowdfunding campaign over at patreon.com/transportevolved. We are now officially halfway to our next big milestone at $1,000, at which point we'll be able to bring in a second member of staff. So please do consider donating if you haven't already and help that total continue to rise. As always, there are lots of stories that we didn't manage to fit into today's show, including a report of our first month with wireless inductive charging on our Nissan Leaf, Electra Girl's BMW i3 turns 2, the website that promotes a Chevy electric car that will never make it to market, and Peugeot Citroën joins forces with Dongfeng to make plug-in cars. So when we're done, be sure to head to our site to read them all. Thanks for watching. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield. Have a great weekend, and until next time, keep evolving.